pain she's been experiencing for months will be no more. Alice Westergaard is also home recovering. She's got an illness going that she just can't be with us yet. So if you can keep Alice in your prayers for healing and recovery. And some sad news for us today. I got a call last evening that Kenny Wachtel suddenly died at home yesterday. Josiah was with him. Josiah found him. He is now with other members of the family. They're taking care of him, but we will miss Kenny. Service arrangements are in the works. I don't know what they're going to be yet, but there will be one for him. That is all the new prayers I have. Do you have any that I may not be aware of?
Betsy, my daughter Betsy, is back to work. She's back rolling the road. They found the last test they took, they've been taking off at the test. The fluid's gone, and so is the spot.
Good. So, prayers answered. That's a good thing.
They do. They are.
Betsy is home back to work and doing well, so that is beautiful. Who called me over here?
I just want to say thank you for all the calls and prayers.
You know, we love you and we pray. So glad you're able to be back with us. Anyone else? I don't see any hands going up, so I invite you to stand at this time as you're able. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Please stay where you are. Turn to greet your neighbors with a friendly wave. Boy, that was fun. Waves take almost as long as regular peace share. I like it. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever.
Amen.
Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Most merciful God,
we confess that we are bound to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed. By what we have done, and by what we have left undone, we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name.
Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us. And for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
First reading this morning is from Genesis chapter 1, starting with the first verse. In the beginning, when God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep, while a wind from God swept over the face of the waters. Then God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw that the light was good, and God separated the light from the darkness. God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And there was evening, and there was morning, the first day. And God said, "Let there be a dome in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." So God made the dome and separated the waters that were under the dome from the waters that were above the dome. And it was so. God called the dome sky, and there was evening, and there was morning, the second day. And God said, let the waters under the sky be gathered together into one place, and let the dry land appear. And it was so. God called the dry land earth, and the waters that were gathered together he called seas. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let the earth put forth vegetation, plants yielding seed, and fruit trees of every kind on earth that bear fruit with the seed in it. And it was so. The earth brought forth vegetation, plants yielding seed of every kind, and trees of every kind bearing fruit with the seed in it. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the third day. And God said, let there be lights in the dome of the sky to separate the day from the night. And let them be for signs and for seasons and for days and years. And let them be lights in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth. And it was so. God made the two great lights, the greater light to rule the day and the lesser light to rule the night, and the stars. God set them in the dome of the sky to give light upon the earth, to rule over the day and over the night, and to separate the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fourth day. And God said, let the waters bring forth swarms of living creatures, and let birds fly above the earth across the dome of the sky. So God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that moves of every kind, with which the waters swarm, and every winged bird of every kind. And God saw that it was good. God blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the waters and the seas, and let birds multiply on the earth. And there was evening, and there was morning, the fifth day. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures of every kind, cattle and creeping things and wild animals of the earth of every kind. And it was so. God made the wild animals of the earth of every kind and the cattle of every kind and everything that creeps upon the ground of every kind. And God saw that it was good. Then God said, let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all the wild animals of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. So God created humankind in his image. In the image of God, he created them. Male and female, he created them. God blessed them, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply, and fill the earth and subdue it, and have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves upon the earth. So God said, see, I have given you every plant yielding seed that is upon the face of all the earth, and every tree with seed in its fruit, and you shall have them for food. And to every beast of the earth, and to every bird of the air, and to everything that creeps on the earth, everything that has the breath of life, I have given every green plant for food. And it was so. God saw everything that he had made, and indeed it was very good. And there was evening, and there was morning, the sixth day. Thus the heavens and the earth were finished, and all their multitude. And on the seventh day God finished the work that he had done, and he rested on the seventh day from all the work that he had done. So God blessed the seventh day and hallowed it, because on it God rested from all the work that he had done in creation. These are the generations of the heavens and the earth when they were created. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let's read responsibly Psalm 8. O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth.
You, whose glory is chanted above the heavens, and the children. You have set up
fortress against your enemies, to silence the foe and the avenger.
When I consider your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars you have set in their courses,
what are your mortals that you should be mindful of them, human beings that you should care for them?
Yet you have made them little less than divine. With glory and honor you crown them.
You have made them rule over the works of your hands. You have put all things under their feet.
All flocks and cattle, even the wild beasts of the field.
The birds of the air, the fish of the sea, and whatever passes along the paths of the sea.
O Lord, our Lord, how majestic is your name in all the earth. The second reading is from 2 Corinthians chapter 13. Paul writes, "Finally, brothers and sisters, farewell. Put things in order. Listen to my appeal. Agree with one another. Live in peace, and the God of love and peace will be with you. Greet one another with a holy kiss. All the saints greet you. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with all of you." The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
More fairly. And that helps creation. Do you know that we are made co-creators with God? He has empowered us to keep the creation going. Naturally, we may never be at God's level of creator, but we do create some things in His name, and that is our mission, to create peace and goodwill and to keep this creation very good. Grace and peace to you from God our Father, from Jesus the Christ, our Lord and Savior, and from the Holy Spirit, our advocate and guide. Amen. Yeah. Origin stories. We all have them, and many people go to great lengths to learn about theirs. Just look at how popular Ancestry.com has become in recent years. But how often do we think about the origin stories of our faith? I'm not talking here so much about our own introductions to the faith individually. Instead, I'm talking about the beginning of our faith understandings that have led to the development of our creeds and our doctrinal beliefs. Yes, this is Trinity Sunday, but the readings all lead us to go deeper than the doctrine of the Holy Trinity, to see where this and so many others of our foundational beliefs actually began. And so we begin at the very beginning with the first full account of the creation. United Methodist pastor Andrew Chekel, writing for the lectionary blog Modern Metanoia, points out that in his introduction to Genesis, Theodor Hybert shares that the writer's goal was to make sense of the world the Hebrews knew by explaining how it came into being. They came to terms with who they were as a people by explaining their own origins in the world. Thus, Genesis 1:1-2:4 begins the Torah with a story detailing a very harmonious and beautifully structured creation, not unlike the structure of Israel's religious life, with the goal of articulating the climax of creation, the Sabbath. I found this quite surprising, as I never considered the Sabbath to be the climax of the creation. That may be a difficult concept for us because we have moved so far from observing the Sabbath as the great gift that God both gave us and commanded us to keep. But this is not the case for the devout Jews, even today. They not only rest from earthly work as much as they are able, but they also keep mechanical objects, like elevators, from working on the Sabbath as well. Of course, this can't be totally the case in the big tourist hotels, like in Jerusalem, where one elevator bank is allowed to operate on the Sabbath for those of other faiths and those that do not observe the Sabbath as they have been commanded, so that they are not inconvenienced. As we all know, this is not what God had in mind. The Sabbath is not simply about not doing any work for one day. Yes, our bodies and our minds and our souls need time to rest and to be restored. And I do believe that the Sabbath is intended to provide the opportunity for us to do just that. But I also believe that the Sabbath is about taking intentional time to be in and deepen our relationship with God. And that I can see as being the climax of creation. We have a God who created everything, from light to all living creatures, including Leviathan, the great sea monster, simply for the enjoyment of watching them grow and frolic and thrive under God's ongoing provision and care. And it is this same God who created humankind to share in the creative process, to serve as stewards of all that God has created, and to be in loving relationship with each other and with Him. In other words, this is the origin story that tells us who and whose we are. Therefore, it becomes very clear that the creation account is the origin story of everything that exists, including the Sabbath. But there is so much more to look at here, especially on Trinity Sunday. For in these very first verses of the Hebrew Scriptures, which we have been blessed to now call our own as well, we see the three persons of the Trinity active in creation together. For we read in verses 1-3 that in the beginning, When God created the heavens and the earth was a formless void, and darkness covered the face of the deep. While a wind from God swept over the face of the waters, then God said, let there be light. And there was light. Okay, so we recognize God the Creator here, but the other two persons of the Trinity are here as well. First, we have the wind from God, which could also be translated as the Spirit from God, who swept over the face of the waters. And then we hear God creating through speech, or through the very Word of God, whom we have come to know better as Jesus. Yes, we have to look a little harder to find Jesus and the Spirit here, but from the very first words of our Bible, our origin story begins with the three persons of the Trinity, active in creation together. The theme of the glory of creation continues in the psalm, reiterating a lot that has been set down in the Genesis account, but it also gives a lot more attention to what it means that God said, let us make humankind in our image, according to our likeness, and let them have dominion over the fish of the sea and over the birds of the air and over the cattle and over all the wild animals of the earth and over every creeping thing that creeps upon the earth. This being made in God's image is the true origin of our identity as beloved children of God and stewards of creation. And yet, as theologian Elizabeth Webb reminds us, we bear the image of God. We are not God. Our finitude and fallibility must be kept in mind as we exercise our responsibility. We are a part of the creation over which God has granted us dominion. We do not stand apart from our fellow creatures, but we stand with them. All creatures, including human beings, live in interdependence with one another. As much as we have dominion over creation, we are also dependent upon it for our well-being. Our sovereignty can never mean that we place ourselves over against the creation. As lords over creation, we are in fact servants of it. Next, chronologically speaking, we turn to our gospel reading. Interestingly, having spent a lot of time in John and Luke recently, we finally are back to Matthew's gospel. But we are welcomed back with its very last verses, which are commonly known as the Great Commission. This may seem an odd choice given our theme of origin stories, until we realize that this is how Matthew presents the origin of the church. But let's take a closer look. First, it is important to know that in this gospel, this is the only encounter the risen Christ has with his disciples. Mary Magdalene and the other Mary had gone to the tomb on Easter morning, where they experienced an earthquake and saw an angel of the Lord come down and roll the stone away. The angel then told the women that Jesus had indeed been raised, just as he had said. And he sent them to tell the disciples that they were to go to Galilee, for Jesus would meet them there. But while they were still on their way, Jesus met them on the road, and they worshiped him. Then he repeated the instructions the angel had given him, and the women continued on to share what they had seen and heard. Apparently taking the women at their word, which was anything but a given back then, the disciples headed out to Galilee. And once there, they too had a firsthand experience with the risen Lord. It is worth noting that this encounter took place on a mountain, which is often a place of theophanies or God encounters, especially in Matthew's gospel. Jesus withdrew to mountains to pray. A lot of holy encounters take place on high spaces. Once the disciples arrived and saw Jesus, they, like the women before them, worshipped him. But Matthew includes the interesting note that, but some doubted. We don't typically think of worship and doubt as going together, but we have to remember the circumstances here. The disciples had believed that they had lost their mentor, their teacher, their friend, their Messiah, when Jesus was crucified outside of Jerusalem's city walls. And now they find him standing before them in Galilee. This must have caused them to experience a bit of confusion and doubt. or what is more technically called cognitive dissonance, which means that what was being seen or experienced did not match with their understandings of the ways the world works. Looking at it from this perspective, I would guess that we would all have to admit that we too experience times of worship and doubt together. For we too are called to believe in things beyond our understanding, beyond the ways that the world typically works. But I digress. Let's get back. Jesus then came to them, saying that he had been given all authority in heaven and on earth. Professor Craig Kester shares the following story, writing that when I was in college, a professor made some comments in one of my religion classes that prompted me to ask what he meant by the word authority. Perhaps it was one of those attempts by a college sophomore to press a point in a manner that sounded profound. Perhaps it reflected a genuine desire to grasp something that I had not fully understood. But the professor responded with a single word that brought a level of clarity I had never forgotten. He said, authority is followability. Followability. He probably coined the word on the spot, but it did what it needed to do. True authority is what gives people the confidence to follow. And this is what Jesus says about himself. Jesus clearly had followability. After all, the disciples had been following him for some 3 years, and they had now followed his instructions to meet him in Galilee. Then, claiming that full authority, Jesus tells them to go therefore. Go therefore. Because of the authority in Jesus, I can now command you to go therefore and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything that I have commanded you. And here we get the connection to Trinity Sunday. For he names each of the three persons of the Trinity and says that they are to be invoked when new disciples are being baptized. This is a command that we continue to follow to this day. And it is the origin story of how the church was to be formed and expanded. Not as individual worshiping communities that like to follow their set patterns and have their own way of believing and doing things, but as a bringing together of all nations into the one universal church. Finally, in our reading from 2 Corinthians, we have the origin of parts of our liturgy, including the passing of the peace, as we are told to greet one another with a holy kiss, and the greeting that is shared each time we come to worship. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Again, we have the Trinity named in relation to our worship practices. We have to note here, however, that these references to the persons of the Trinity were all written long before any official doctrine of the Holy Trinity was formulated. And this, to me, makes that all the more powerful. For the Trinity was clearly being known on a personal level as God interacted in different ways with each of his followers. And we also need to note that despite having a formal doctrine of the Trinity, we can no more fully explain it than Paul or the writers of Genesis could. So we have traced the origin stories given to us in our readings today, but there are so many more origin stories that affect each one of us. Each family, church, community, and nation has its own origin stories, and we tend to know only those that affect us personally. This past week, however, we have all been given the opportunity to learn some of the origin stories that have deeply impacted so many of our Black brothers and sisters, the stories of limited rights and opportunities for some citizens of our country, the stories of distrust and fear experienced by people who are routinely seen as less than. The stories of love and courage and coming together, as we are all drawn to see that we are all created in the image of God. And our differences truly are only skin deep. And this is the message that Jesus gives us today. For he called disciples who were seen as less than by other members of the communities. And he sends us to make disciples of all nations, We are to be gathered as one unified and loving body, representing the love and the unity of the Holy Spirit. We have a lot of work to do to write a new chapter in the origin story of love and acceptance for all that Jesus started for us so very long ago. But we can do it with the help of our triune God. Amen. God of community, you form us as your church. Guide our bishops, pastors, deacons, and other worship leaders as they lead the church in these trying times. With all the baptized, may they be strengthened to share the good news of Jesus Christ, and in prayer and action strive for peace and justice in all the earth. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of creation, you called everything into being. Sustain this world with your renewing care. Instill in us a deeper wonder for the created world you've called good, and a greater humility for our place within it. Kindle in us a creative and resilient spirit as we care for the earth and its creatures. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of counsel, all authority belongs to you. Encourage leaders to seek wisdom and respond with courage and compassion to those most in need. We pray for community leaders in this time of unrest. Further the work of advocates who pursue justice in often ignored communities. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of care, you created us in your image. We are your beloved children. May we recognize your likeness in one another. We pray for all who are mourning the death of your beloved child, George Floyd. Hold in your loving embrace all experiencing trauma, fear, uncertainty, and loss. Protect vulnerable children and adults from violence or neglect. Provide what is needed for those lacking access to food, shelter, and other services. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of healing, you accompany us in sickness and suffering. Bring relief to all afflicted with the coronavirus and all those isolated now more than ever, especially those in prison and care facilities. Strengthen caregivers, health workers, and all whose work ensures the safety and well-being of others. Console, heal, and nourish all who are ill, nearing death, or in any need this day. We pray especially today for Kathy, Alice, Dolores, Veda Ann, Dar, Sandy, Donna, Wanda, Jean, Dion, Edwin, Brian, Hope, Olivia, Max, Crystal, for the families and loved ones of Kenny Wachtel, for the children of the Mission of the Good Shepherd and all who have been orphaned or feel alone, for all of our homebound members and friends, and for those whom we name now, either aloud or in the silence of our hearts. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of connection, you call us to make your presence known. Accompany people of faith as they nurture relationships in new ways. Where the sin of racism fractures our relationships, bring repentance and reconciliation. Free us for the difficult work ahead in our congregations and communities. Open our hearts for attentive listening so that our places of connection are filled with your spirit. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of love, we pray for all who are celebrating birthdays or wedding anniversaries today or in the coming week, especially Sherry Kuba, Cleo Holm, and Earl Liston. Grant that their special days be filled with thankfulness and joy, and help them to grow closer to their loved ones and to you. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of mercy, we pray for all first responders, members of the military, and their families. Strengthen them in their trials and temptations. Give them the courage to face the perils that surround them, and continue to hold them close, Lord, wherever they may be. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of unity, we pray as Jesus taught us, for our enemies and for those people we find hard to love. Reconcile us with them and grant us the peace that only you can bring. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
God of compassion, you comfort us in our grief with the promise of the resurrection. We give you thanks for the saints of all times and in our lives. Continue to lead us in your ways until that day when we too are gathered with all your saints at your eternal banquet. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
Receive these prayers, O God, and those too deep for words, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
You may be seated, and it is now the time when we will be receiving the offering. But I instead invite you at this time, if you have not done so, to fill out your attendance card so that you can drop them in the plate on your way out.
Thank you.
pray. Creator God, you made everything, and you provide for every need. The bread we break and the wine we pour come from you. As we eat and drink with thanksgiving, fill us with your love. Let that love flow through us to others, and join us to the saints before us in a holy and boundless communion. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen.
Give us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass.
As Lutherans, we believe that Jesus invites us all to his table. So come to the banquet, for all is now ready.
Thank you.
Please stand.
The body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen.
Amen.
Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Receive the blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord's face shine upon you with grace and mercy. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Christ is with you.
Thanks be to God.